Hello and welcome to Woman Up, the podcast series by Desperate Artwives. Woman Up is a podcast talking to women artists, creatives, art critics, feminist historians, activists and more. The series was conceived by Desperate Artwives founder Amy Dignam in collaboration with me, Susan Merrick. Desperate Artwives is a platform established in 2010 for women artists who are also mothers and carers. Amy's work focuses on domestic disorder, unsteady identity, power and dysfunction. And I'm an artist interested in feminism, language, power and access. In this platform, we share conversations with women that inspire us and our work, whilst producing a long-form content of resources for other people to access. Hello and welcome to Woman Up, our very first Christmas special episode. And we have an amazing episode for you today. Just about a month ago, we got to speak to the most fantastic, amazing activist artists that we can think of, the Guerrilla Girls. They have an amazing new book out called The Guerrilla Girls, The Art of Behaving Badly, which is effectively a chronology of their work over the 35-year period. It's amazing. It's beautiful. We'll have a link to the episode where you can get it from. But let's crack on with the episode so you can hear about the book, but also about the work of the Guerrilla Girls from the last 35 years. Hello and welcome to Woman Up. Today, I'm delighted to be speaking to the Guerrilla Girls. For those who don't know, the Guerrilla Girls are anonymous artist activists who use disruptive headlines, outrageous visuals and killer statistics to expose gender and ethnic bias and corruption in art, film, politics and pop culture. They believe in an intersectional feminism that fights for human rights for all people and all genders. They undermine the idea of a mainstream narrative by revealing the understory, the subtext, the overlooked, and the downright unfair. Guerrilla Girls, The Art of Behaving Badly is the first book to document their hundreds of street projects all over the world, as well as interventions and exhibitions blasting museums on their own walls for their discriminatory practices. The Guerrilla Girls' motto is do one thing. If it works, do another. If it doesn't, do another anyway. Keep chipping away. Creative complaining works. So today we're lucky enough to be speaking to two long-standing members of the Guerrilla Girls, using, of course, their Guerrilla Girl pseudonyms. Hello, Guerrilla Girls. Please, can you introduce yourselves?
I'm Frida Kahlo. I'm one of the founding members of the Guerrilla Girls.
And I'm Kata Kolwitz, also one of the founding members.
So great to have you guys on the call. Thank you for joining the podcast.
Thank you.
So Amy and I met you both at the Tate Exchange Complaints Department about 3 years ago, and your work's inspired some of the public takeovers that Desperate Artwives has done. So we're very grateful to have met you and to be inspired by you as artists ourselves. Could one of you give me a brief background as to who the Guerrilla Girls are, for those who might be new to the art world or new to your work? How did you start, and what was the key message?
Why don't you go ahead, Kata?
Okay. Well, we were artists in New York who were pissed off that almost all the opportunities went to white men in the 1980s when we started out. And you just have to kind of imagine the whole thing. We think about it and we just look back on it and imagine it. We go to a protest outside the Museum of Modern Art after it opens an international exhibition in 1984. There were 169 artists in this exhibition. Only 13 were women. Only 8 were artists of color. And immediately we understood that no museum goer even cared. That was our aha moment. You know, we're on this picket line, everyone's just going into the museum. People think the museum knows best, and that's all it is. And we realized there just had to be an in-your-face, more contemporary way, using persuasive strategies like used in advertising to break through people's notions and prove to them that the art system is not a meritocracy. There was rampant discrimination at work.
Wow. I am. When I read myself about how you started, and then seeing the beautiful book, which I can't hold up because, well, I can hold up on the Zoom call, but for the podcast, nobody will see me doing it. It's absolutely beautiful, the book. I've loved reading through it, seeing where you started and the progress as you've come through with the work, but also the repetition, the fact that you've had to keep repeating these messages. Does that become frustrating, or is that the momentum for you in your work?
Well, it's always kind of three steps forward, two steps back. You know, progress in the world isn't constant. So, and it also gives us a chance to go back and think about things again and, you know, try something another way. We're always listening to people's response to what we do, and that has a lot to do with what we do next. I mean, that's sort of part of try one thing. If it works, try another. If it doesn't work, try another anyway. That's sort of what that's about.
Yeah. Well, I have to say, because I was lucky enough to have a copy of the book, my 9-year-old daughter was having a look through it, and she saw the poster naked for the first time. And she just said, "Yeah, that's a really good question, Mom." So it's great to see work that still has so much relevance and see it for me, for, you know, with new eyes as well.
Did she sort of apply that to other aspects of culture where women are so often unclothed but so seldom given voice?
Yeah, and she started noticing it in films and books and pointing it out and getting very frustrated, which is horrible and amazing all in one. Horrible that she has to see it, but great that she's acknowledging it and noticing.
Well, we got a convert.
Yeah, exactly.
But, you know, that poster is such an interesting example of how we craft our work, because someone else might have done a poster that just said, there aren't enough women artists hanging in the Metropolitan Museum of Art in New York, and we probably would not be here talking to you today, because we did find a way into this that is kind of unforgettable by counting the number of naked women's bodies in the paintings versus the incredibly low number of actual art by women artists in the museum. Once you've seen that poster, you can never, I dare you to go into a museum and not think about what is on the walls and why. And we've deepened our critique over the years, because a lot of times what you see on the walls is there for reasons having to do with big money controlling art. You know, museums get donations from wealthy collectors. They collect a certain kind of thing. Some of them are incredible and devoted to all kinds of art, but many of them just go with the most expensive, big time, most famous artists. And museums are kind of stuck with those collections of old white men, when the art world has moved way beyond that. And the world of artists today is incredibly diverse and wonderful.
I think the humor in it was also kind of important. And I remember early on people saying, well, you know, art can't be funny. you know, well, why not? You know, every other aspect of human expression, you know, deals with humor. And humor can be very biting and it can really be penetrating. And you sometimes can get to something very quickly with, you know, one humorous line rather than 350 footnotes.
Yeah, and I think you say somewhere in the book that how humor as well has been a really useful tool in broaching subjects, in broaching the issues that you broach to wider audiences as well.
Yeah, I mean, also, you know, we've had over all the years, we've had over 60 members of our group, very diverse. Almost every one of them has had a great sense of humor. And it's just something I think we were born with, and it's a great way to break through people's preconceived notions. And we couldn't not use humor. I think that's really what it's about.
So that links to a question I had about the process and how you work, how you put together a book, how you create the works, the posters, the billboards, the individual pieces, exhibitions. Do you always work as a collaborative? Do you have a couple of you who do more of the work because you're involved for longer? And also alongside that, how in all the work that you do, going on the Late Show, you know, doing interviews, how do you manage to keep the anonymity, which I know is so important for the work?
Whoa, lots of questions there.
Sorry.
Well, the anonymity is just, you know, it's just something that helps us. Early on, it was kind of self-protective because, you know, we sort of wanted to survive in the professional art world that was ignoring us. So it just made sense that we didn't want people to know who we were. But then we realized that, you know, anonymity has such an important part in American history. Our, you know, some very important early documents that were the Federalist Papers, you know, before our Constitution, were all written anonymously by the early patriots because they were afraid of being retaliated by the British crown. So anyway, being anonymous was really important. And the way we work is kind of hormonal. I'm sure that Kata has more to say about that.
You know, we've really stuck with our new idea about how to do political art, and we try to extend it and apply it to as many places as we can. And we really have fun trying to figure all this stuff out. I have to say also, it's such a golden age of activism. There's so many amazing activists and artists activists who are all doing incredible work. And I think the important thing really is to always test out what you're doing. You know, even all these years later, I mean, with our newer members, you know, and the two of us who've been around for so long, you're never sure you're really communicating until you show something to someone who hasn't seen it and hasn't been part of the process. And you don't ask them, is this good? Is this any good? You ask them, what are we trying to say here? And if they play it back to you, and if they're kind of delighted by it also, or scared by it, or, you know, gobsmacked by it, you know you've got a good piece of work.
I wanted to ask that your work specifically at times has focused on art institutions. And I read in the recent interview you did with the Guardian newspaper here in the UK that these are meant to be democratic educational institutions because that's where art collectors go to appreciate the value of their collections and buy influence, get inside a trader and art wash their bad reputations by appearing to support culture. So who do you think the work in museums is really for? Do you think it's really for wider audiences? Do you think some museums really do try to open that up? I know you touched on this slightly earlier, but you know, is it still this other special patriarchal place, or is it, are they widening?
Well, that's the problem. It's actually both. I mean, their museums still have boards of directors who are wealthy art collectors, and they do want to promote their collections. But the people inside museums, you know, there are some great people inside so many museums. They are trying to push things forward, just as all the outside agitators like we are and some fantastic organizations that are fighting museums. Museums need to be more diverse in terms of staff. They need to show more diverse work. And they are for the public. And they haven't been behaving that way enough in the last, you know, several decades or ever.
Talking about diversity, I know that racial representation as well as gender representation
have been really important issues for you as a group from the start.
So the Guerrilla Girls as a group of people, do you feel that you have always been pretty representative as a group in terms of why and who and what you've challenged?
Yes, we have been diverse, and that's been really important because we need many different voices in this conversation about culture. And you can't speak for someone else. They really, for the same reason we need to see the art, you know, of all the voices in our culture, we also need all the voices of the culture in our work to, you know, to in a way describe the problem.
I love how much your work invites collaboration and accountability, and more often than not, using threat of exposure to institutions and artists. For example, the Dear Art Collectors, Letter to Male Artists, that kind of work. So that approach is really useful and necessary to me. How has it been taken over the years? Do you still get hate mail? I saw the examples in the book.
I guess we're at a point now where, of course, there are still haters, but most of our mail is quite the opposite. We get thousands of emails and DMs from people all over the world, you know, like 8 years old to 80 years old, telling us that they use us as a model for doing their own activist work. And they describe some of the things that they do. We got a letter from a 9-year-old saying, my school did this, that, and that, we're going to the mattresses, you know? And that's fantastic. I mean, we believe in you know, pushing this rock up a hill, and so many other people do too. And they're doing great work. The problems are horrible and really, you know, almost impossible to solve, but there's so much will to try and to keep up the fight for change.
However, I mean, we have, I think we have succeeded in changing the consciousness of, you know, people who love art and for whom art means a lot. But if you start to dissect the way art is bought, is sold, is possessed, is owned, is traded, is collected, is given away, it really still is in the hands of a small handful of people. Because art, you know, it has this characteristic of being a valuable object, a single solitary object that can only be in one place at one time. It becomes a commodity that wealthy people fight over because everyone wants to have the most expensive, you know, work of art. So I would say at the level of public consciousness and at the point of knowledge, we've had an effect, but the art world is still run on money. And it's, you know, art has unfortunately become an instrument of investment. And, you know, all those people probably pay lip service to the Guerrilla Girls, but they still, you know, buy and sell art and want to make money on it. And if you look at the boards of trustees of American museums, you won't see too many art experts there. You won't see too many artists. You won't see too many people who know a lot about art, but you'll see a lot of names of people with money.
Your work over the years has responded to social issues, political issues, and current affairs. Have there ever been any issues that you have challenged but have been nervous about challenging?
You know, we've never been systematic, so it's not like we have our 5-year plan, we're going to do this, we're going to do that. We just take on one thing after another and see what we can do with it. So there have been times when we've had an idea for something, but it never really works out. So it's really hard to look at us that way, because there's so much we haven't done. But we like to reassure ourselves a little bit that there's also so much we have done.
Oh, well, I think this book, hundreds of pages book, and the beautiful images and the powerful, powerful messages in it are tantamount to that, or evidence of that, I should say. So I tried to do some, I'm such a biased interviewer because I love your work and I'm a huge fan. And I've got post-it notes all through the book, and I don't have time to ask you about everything. But I wanted to say, feminism as medicine, yes. And why don't we have more feminism in education? I have lots of post-its, but I also tried to find some artistic criticism to try and balance things out. And you know what? It's really hard to find because everybody just loves what you do, which is amazing. And I found one thing by Roberta Smith a long time ago. She flipped it round in the same interview to say how you are so needed and all of the work that you do is essential and needed to carry on. So I think that says a lot, doesn't it?
Well, if everybody loves us so much, how come the system is still so corrupt and rotten?
That's a really good point. And why have you still not had any huge shows in the USA?
That's pretty obvious, I think.
People are frightened of you, which is the good thing. But yeah.
It is a good thing. They should be very afraid. Yeah. We're not planning to stop anytime soon.
Well, you know, so much of the art world is about socializing, and it's such a kind of upper middle class clubby place where people get together to have cocktails and celebrate things, and no one would ever think of saying something negative in a situation like that. And we just came out and did it, and you know, I'm glad for it.
Yeah.
No, actually, I think, you know, it used to be that there was a lot of discourse when people went around to shows and galleries and stuff. It was about arguing and discussing things because, you know, it's all speculative anyway. But I think now, as art has become part of the celebrity culture, people are more likely to talk about what an artist wears or what kind of fancy, you know, place they live in, you know, than to discuss what goes on in the work itself. And we go right to the core of it. You know, every one of our posters points its finger at something that needs to be talked about.
How have you managed going into institutions themselves, for example, when you're invited in and they invite you in knowing the kind of work you do, but then still seem surprised when you dissect them as well and find the discrimination within their own, you know, is it usually expected, or do you still surprise people?
Well, we try to be really fierce no matter what we're doing. And it is really kind of a thrill that these people who run museums and curators of museums invite us to examine them and attack them on their own walls. We feel that our work inside a museum that is critical of the museum is fantastic for museum goers because they get a completely new experience that makes them look at all the art in the museum forever on in a different way. And you know, there's so much fantastic art. The real problem is, for all those reasons that Frida was talking about, all those money reasons, museums are not casting a wide enough net. They really need to be showing the width, breadth, and diversity of our culture because there's so much incredible, great art. And so the wider, the better. You know, if they're spending millions of dollars to buy one thing, that is not collecting art. That is just, you know, making a history of wealth and power. And don't we have enough of that history in the world? We got to get rid of that history.
Actually, I remember a funny circumstance when we were invited to do a project to celebrate the anniversary of the museum in Köln. And it was to sort of celebrate the founder of the museum, who was a chocolate baron, and actually He so conflated his business with his art spending that every place he had a chocolate factory, he would build a museum. And of course, you know, there were all kinds of tax, you know, reverberations and accommodations and that were made for him. Anyway, instead of sort of praising him, we sort of talked about how he started a really bad tradition of private museums where rich people can buy up all the, you know, the art they think is most important and make it their own museum and in a way control it, you know, then it becomes their property rather than, you know, the domain of everyone. And we were reading the script to the director of the museum over the phone because we just didn't want him to be like blindsided by what we were doing, and you could hear him gulp. And then once we got there to do the installation, he felt that he had to have us speak to the whole of their curatorial staff. And it was really interesting, the questions they were asking us, because in Germany, for example, they don't have a word for person of color. They have some really awful hangover words that just did not sound great to us. So we had to discuss and negotiate all of that. But it was really interesting to sit down with them. And I could be wrong, but I think by the end of the time we spent with them, we had taught them something. And that was immeasurably, you know, valuable.
Yeah.
But you know, that's happening. It's happening so much right now. I mean, people invite us, people in the museum invite us because they are pushing inside for these things to happen too. I mean, we're not going to get invited by the curator in this case was one of those people who wants to do something different, you know, push the envelope, outrageous, etc. And we are happy to oblige because it's the only way we know to do work.
So how will you keep going, keep the momentum going? And what's your advice to other perhaps budding activist artists?
This is your time. You know, the world is looking for a reset and the world needs some new ideas. This, you know, pandemic has made everything kind of grind to a halt. And it's a perfect time for change.
And I don't think we need to tell artists anything. I think artists are doing incredible work, organizers, activists as well. But there's so much, all art has always been political, art is part of its own time. And so many artists are, in their own way, have the same goals that we have and are doing an amazing job.
I would like to ask you for the final question, because I'm not sure how much time we have. What moment or moments would you be able to pinpoint, if you've had them, as your, okay, that's it, that's why we're doing this?
Boy, that's a really tough one. There's been so much. I could say, I don't know if this really is an answer to your question, but what I could say is it's been fascinating for us and all our members over the years ourselves to look at this picture book, which we have has been a huge labor of love to create and put out into the world, because you can really see the trajectory of this work. You know, racism, anti-racism from the beginning, anti-sexism, progressive issues, anti-war, so many things just thread through this work. And you can see it's the history of the world right now and what we, so many people, not just us, are doing. And we've done it in a really creative way, as have so many other artists and activists. So that's been a fascinating thing, just to see the accumulation of these hundreds of projects and what it all adds up to together.
Yeah, I have to say, when I looked at the book and looked at the material we were putting together, I'd forgotten a lot of this stuff, but all of it is the glue that holds it together. One thing leads to the next, and it does it tells a story. You know, it tells a story and a little history in itself. And for everything else aside, I think that what we've done is we've produced a body of knowledge.
Absolutely. I think the book is full of beautiful, powerful imagery. It's an amazing history, as you say, of our time and of the time and the work of the Guerrilla Girls. Also, I was really excited when I found my own Guerrilla Girl mask cardboard cutout at the back. I haven't tried it yet, but I whooped when I saw it. So it's just proving that Guerrilla Girls can be everywhere and anywhere. So all museums, institutions, organisations, beware. And I'd like to say thank you very much to both of you for your time today.
Thank you. And good luck with your work also.
And if we could say to your listeners, put a gorilla mask on, you'll be surprised what comes out of your mouth.
Thanks for listening. I'm Susan Merrick, and this is Woman Up, the podcast series by Desperate Artwives. For more of our episodes, please visit the Desperate Artwives website or go to Apple Podcasts. Merry Christmas and happy holidays, everyone.